The hedgehog, a little fierce animal with a lot of bite. Today we're going to see a game. It actually doesn't start as a hedgehog, but the structure is very quickly a hedgehog. So we will take it here as this will be instructive for players interested in understanding the nature of the hedgehog. It's a great game. It made a big impression on me when I was a young player, and I was always looking for ways to play like this. The hero of today's game is the Hungarian András Black is OK Adorján, and it's from 1983, so it's an old game, and he's beating the Danish top player, who was the European Duke champion at that time, or was, yeah, I think he was, and on his way to become a grandmaster and very strong player. So we see the startup as the English, and here, and this is not the hedgehog, this is the double fianchetto. It's a very interesting variation as well. I've played this with black also. It's a little bit different than the hedgehog. Nowadays, white has found some remedies that are a bit annoying for black. So I'm not that excited anymore about this. But it still has some. I think it's correct. You can play this line for sure. Black has nice bishops on b7 and g7 and our eye towards the center. And taking with the knight is nowadays considered wrong. White should keep, he has more space, so he should keep more pieces on the board. Allowing the exchange of bishop is to black's advantage in general, since white's king side will actually be kind of weak, as we will see in the game. So he will miss the bishop. So in this position, the best move is without doubt queen takes d4, and there's a lot of theory after that move. Black will go d6, knight bd7, and have a very harmonious setup. But white does have more space, and it will be a strong an interesting battle lying ahead. I can recommend playing these lines. It's something you will learn from. So we exchange and castle and e4. White is getting on with the center. Black threatens this pawn, and here and knight c6 attacking the knight, and it jumps here, and black plays a6, and maybe here white should maybe play this move, I think, just to equalize, because after this move, I'm not sure he can equalize anymore, because black starts to build up the real hedgehog, and even though the knight here is a bit clumsy, the rest of the pieces are good, and of course white would love to get something here. Usually the problem with the knight on c6 is that the rook here allows something like this, but this is not going to happen here, both because the knight is on c2, but also because there are bishop on c1 and so on. And black will of course move. And notice that it goes into this diagonal. This is a very typical thing for these kind of structures that white black is trying to eye the king, having a lot of x-rays effect. You also love to have the rook on the same the same file as the queen. But he doesn't play that. He plays this move instead. Maybe he's luring for b5, and Kurt plays f3 and d6, and this is and now we have the hedgehog structure, so we can allow it to be part of the hedgehog series here. Knight e3, knight e5, and all this looks all very natural. We see that this square might be a little weak, but at the moment it's just covered by the queen and the king. So white starts with his usual plan of pressurizing the d pawn, rook d2. And it's here that that black really shows what's going on with this game. It was a very, very interesting move. He plays g5, and that's I remember when I was not playing chess at the time when this game was played, but later on I saw this in the Danish chess magazine, and I was just surprised by this g5. What a move! But of course, it's the idea is to undermine these two pawns here, and it's definitely not easy to move. Please notice that due to the bishop here, which by the way is a normal feature, the black squares will be very weak if white was to go g4, and something like this would be extremely annoying. There is both a check here and a check here and so on, and the check on f4 is of course really strong. So but white keeps on pressurizing, and black goes h5. Because white wanted to take with the knight and say, okay, I have a bad structure, but I have a pawn, and you're not getting the d pawn. But now it's worse because after this move, he cannot take with the knight, and e4 would fall, and opening up for this really unpleasant x-ray. So Kurt realized that, uh-oh, this is not going well. I'll have to retreat. So he tried this move, and black went on with it. And of course, if white was to go here, I think it's safe to say that Adrian would definitely go here. And notice there is also some X-ray effect here. Okay, so Kurt says, okay, I'm defending. I'll have a weak pawn, but you can say this is weak as well. But as we saw with the Korsnoy game, Adrian is not going to defend pawns unless he really, really, really have to. So he would rather play dynamically. And here comes b5. He's ready to undermine the knight on c3. So you b5 or take on c4. So this an f4, and we see this this thing here. Knight g6. And again, rook takes b4, and knight falls, and it's really, really, really nasty. So he takes here and say, okay, I have to stop something, and he plays b4. And just to rub it in, that we are not going to defend this pawn, no matter what. Adrian plays this move to keep the rooks on the open file, saying we're going full dynamic, and it might sit here also, and I probably am threatening to take on c3, and saying knight takes e4, king d1, and this is exactly what happens. This kind of exchange sacrifices are pretty easy, I think, to play because white's position is just such a mess. Very strong knight in the center, attacking chances and a pawn for the exchange. That's usually a good bargain for black. And it just takes back. And I think Kurt here realized that, okay, this is really, really, really not going my way. And knight c3 is threatening. And if just you can play d5 and there will be some queen b6, the knight might come around here, and these rooks will never ever get into the game before I'm just getting totally killed. So he decided to give back the exchange, but his problem with the king, of course, remains. And here there's a check, and white black wins a pawn on a2. So by not defending the pawn, he eventually ended up winning a pawn, and of course the ending is really bad. So Kurt has to try and stay in the game with the queens, but it's actually black who has better attacking chances. But okay, give a check, and sometimes these pawns that has gone forward will leave the black king weak. So even though you win material or something, you still have problems. because black white will try and penetrate with these pieces. Getting the knight into the game, hoping to maybe put it on c5. Queen a8, nice long range move, and keeping all the options of the queen on either side. King goes and queen comes in. Maybe he should play rook f2 here. White will probably play queen c6. Black will play c5. And here comes the undermining h4. And of course, white is kind of getting fed up with being undermined, trying to get into maybe a holdable ending. But black is not having an ending anymore, unless he can get it on these terms, where the rook is coming around in. And the rook has gone from d3, and this is just hopeless. So here white can resign. They played some moves, knight d5, and here Kurt resigned. The passed pawns is going to decide. So please notice this g5 move. That's a nice move, isn't it? It makes you want to go out and play g5 with black. At least it does for me. I think. This is real chess, you know. Thank you for watching.